We're in Colossians chapter 3. We're going to look at verse number 15 in a moment. This is part 3 of the series entitled The Doctrine of Peace. Again, we would remind you of our basic working concept. This is strictly in the mind of someone who is secular. It's a state or condition of security where everybody is together and living free of clamor, confusion, conflict, and coveting. And those are four parts of this definition of peace that are extremely important. Clamor means that no one is coming at you, criticizing you, making undue demands upon your life, blaming you for things that simply are not true, or raising their voice together in a noisy protest. Confusion means that you're oriented to life. You know and you understand. There's no confusion in a state of peace, because when you're upset, you're in turmoil and not peace. There are no opposing opinions in a state of peace. And this is something, of course, that we've been teaching for the longest time. Once you get an eternity future, you don't have a right to your own opinion. That goes for all of us. It's God's way or none. And to avoid any opposing opinion like that of Lucifer to God, he simply removes all opposing opinions. So therefore, there's no conflict in a state of peace. And there's no coveting. The original sin that caused war and strife and hostilities was the sin of coveting. I will be as God. Now, this, of course, implies that you have the absence of worry. Peace is the absence of war and worry, but the presence of tranquility, serenity, order, and harmony. Okay, now, the Bible has some more to say about it. There are three things that are important. One has to do with a reciprocal response, and I like that part. You come to a house, you come to a city, hail peace to it. We want peace with you. If they respond back, peace, then you live together in harmony. And that, of course, is what the gospel call is. God calling peace, and we're responding, yes, Lord, peace. I want to live with you in a like-minded situation. Secondly, you have to have adherence to law, absolute law. If you don't have that by mutual consent, then there is no peace. Eventually, it will be broken. And lastly, you have to have like-minded protocol by everyone involved. Now, there's a second thing regarding this matter of peace that the Bible talks of. First of all, if you want peace, you have to eliminate your enemies. Now, how do you do that? Biblically, two ways. You convert them to friends. God is at enmity with the world, but he hails peace. That's what the gospel of peace is. He wants to convert. I want to be your friend, says God. But if you reject that, time and again, he says, I'll set my face against you and conquer you by eliminating you by literal death. Then the words for peace, shalom and irene. It means to have a secure state of wholeness or oneness based on safety, something that is complete and fulfilled in and of itself. All right, now, where we are now is point three, actually, on this chart, that peace is directional. Now, this is important because the first place peace has to come from is from God. So the first direction is down from above. If we're ever going to have real peace, it's not man to man, it's God to man and a reciprocal response. So the first thing is down from above. That's the original or initial call of peace. But then there is a peace up from beneath. We have peace from God, and then peace with God as we respond to him. Then we're on point three, the peace of God, and we're going to discuss that in greater detail this evening. And then peace with others. Paul says, as much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men. So you get the basic idea here regarding our concept of peace in God's Word. All right, we noted that in Romans 1:7, Paul says we have peace from God. It means down from his ultimate source. God the Father sends peace to the world through God the Son, so that his enemies now can become his friends. The first initial call to peace is to enemies. All right, so there's a second peace. We noted then in Romans 5:1, we have peace with God. And that literally means that we now have the privilege of going all the way face to face into his presence. He withdraws and sets up a battle line for those who are his enemies, but he includes those who are his friends and family. And so the second peace we have, because we're justified by grace, we have peace. And please remember that that is the sequence. Paul says, grace and peace from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace means that we have something from God we could not provide for ourselves. What is that? That is the means of peace. Grace first, and then peace. Once we believe, then the direction is back to the Father. Now, this is only for believers. The first is toward unbelievers or enemies. The second is now toward believers. We trust in Christ as Savior, and through him we have access to the Father. All right? Now we come then to the peace of God. Colossians chapter 3. One of the reasons that I want to spend a lot of time here is because this is something that Christians, most Christians, do not have. This is the inner stability, the inner tranquility, serenity of heart and mind, in a secure assurance. Now, I'm not talking about eternal security. I'm talking about temporal fellowship with God. When you're out of fellowship, you do not have the peace of God. You have peace with God. That's number two, remember. Sure, any believer has peace with God, but not all believers have the peace of God. Now, before I go any further, I want to explain myself. A lot of times, because I'm operating perhaps on a different frame of reference than others, there are newcomers or people don't understand. I want to explain something regarding psychologists, psychiatrists, counselors, and Christian counselors. I believe there is a place for all of these people, but it is a very limited place for those who are truly mentally ill or that have a need that cannot be addressed by the normal means. You've got a problem and you cannot tell your pastor. You would be ashamed to do it. Pastor Moki constantly said, if it involves something that sort of really hairy, he said, Denny, tell him to go to this counselor. Why? He said, because every time they will divulge something of a deep, intimate nature to you, then when they come back to church, they have to look you eyeball to eyeball. And he said, I've lost more people that way. Husband and wife will come in and they'll cut one another down. And now they realize that the pastor knows their intimate business and they don't come back. And that's been true. I've taken his advice and I understand why. There are just some things. There's a line you draw concerning pastor. But there are those professionals, Christian counselors, who can hear that kind of a problem and give a good Bible advice and so forth. Now, what I mean by that those people usually are not good is that on the average, the problem is twofold. One, if you're unsaved, your problem is you need to get saved. Your turmoil of mind and life is because you have rejected Christ as Savior. It's hard for you, said Christ to Paul, to kick against the pricks in your heart. You hurt in your soul. You're guilty. You're ridden with guilt, and you want to get rid of it, but you can't do it, can you, without turning to me? You see, Paul's problem was not getting rid of the guilt. Paul's problem was getting saved. And he could have been on a psychologist's couch or a psychiatrist, paid him all that money, gone through the process for years, and never had peace with himself until he got saved. Okay, the second problem is, with most Christians, is bypassing the means of inculcating Bible doctrine. When you don't come to the local church and learn the Word of God, just like we're doing, the grace apparatus for perception and so forth, eventually you're going to face life from ignorance. You don't know what doctrine applies. You get out of fellowship. Now, your problem is not some counselor. Your problem is spirituality, the filling of the Spirit, knowing what to do in a certain case by covering the doctrine in church. Now, be that as it may, you're either going to learn the easy way right here, or you're going to learn in the school of hard knocks, because it's going to catch up with you, and you might have peace. Oh, yeah, I know. I just go to church once in a while. Okay. No, and I have peace with myself. Sure you do. It's going to come where you have turmoil. Why? Because the only way to have lasting peace is to have the peace of God. Now, this is experiential peace, so that we all understand one another. If you have a problem that is a deep mental disturbance, sure, there's a place for these people. But the normal or the average person simply needs to either get saved or get back in fellowship or church or whatever. All right, verse 15. Let the peace of God, tau, the one that he uses himself. He owns it exclusively. He's got a monopoly on peace. He's never been unhappy with himself. He has total regard for himself. He has the highest spiritual self-esteem. And therefore, what you need in your life is to have spiritual self-esteem. It just means that operating in the flesh is beneath you as a Christian aristocrat, and you operate like God. Have spiritual self-esteem. Now, what can it do for you? This is important. We discussed it this morning, but we're going to take a little more time because I don't want you to miss the point. Bra beyo'o. Now, what is a bra beos? It means one who is a controller or a determiner of the Olympic Games. It's an umpire. He calls out, he calls safe, he calls the shots. He is the final appellate in the Olympic Games. You can't go beyond him. Once he says that's the way it is, it's final. Now, this has to do with you. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts. All right. Now, the word heart there literally means core or command post of your soul. Now, here's what they would do at the Olympic Games. This Brabeus would set up a command center, and he would have other assistants under him. And if somebody wanted to appeal, they would go to where he was located. And then he would hear their complaints and so forth. He would weigh the issues, and then he would render a decision, right or wrong. So, if you want to have God's peace in your heart and life, you must know how to decide the issues like God decides them. And so, therefore, you have to be exposed to the Word of God on a regular, systematic basis. Otherwise, you simply cannot know, you can't make the right decision. If you don't make the right decision, you're in turmoil. Do you see the problem you have? I can't make the right decision because I don't know. I'm not in fellowship. And therefore, you're going to make the decisions of your life from a position of weakness, and your final arbiter here is going to, as it were, throw the game. You want to feel good, so you appeal to your emotions rather than objective law, and you throw the game. You're bought out, as it were, in the command post of your soul. But if you want the peace of God, you've got to know the rights and the wrongs as far as decisions to be made. All right, now, let's go to the book of Philippians. This book, Philippians, is a favorite book of many folks. Verse 7, chapter 4. And the peace which belongs to God himself, which passes. Now, here's an interesting thing about this particular word, passes. It is the Greek word huper echo. Echo, to have and to hold. Huper means above and beyond. You have and hold something when you have the peace of God that is above and beyond what? Understanding, literally human comprehension. The natural man or the carnal man cannot understand that in all situations of life, you are safe and secure in your relationship with God. Why? Because the peace of God keeps your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Phrareo, it literally is a garrison. Now, God wants to garrison your heart. We discussed what a Roman garrison was. We'll just put a sword here, a sword here, a sword here, and one here. You are in charge of the command post. But as you fill your soul with the Word of God, it too becomes a protector of your soul. And it protects from any oncoming, as it were, enemies that try to penetrate the fortress of your soul. A garrison is a fellow who is a sentinel on the wall of a fortified city. He is the first line of defense. He provides two things. Number one, sight. Here they come. You're sleeping there in the city, but they're ready to fight. They see them. And then might. They repel all invaders. So if you want to have constant peace, number one, you have to make the right decision in the command post of your soul. And two, you have to take in doctrine, which itself provides the sentinel of your soul. See, that's what it says. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, aletheia, doctrinal things, as in verse number 8. See, be careful for nothing, verse 6, everything by prayer and supplication. Let your requests be made known unto God. What request? Well, requests on true things, honest things, just, pure, lovely things, things that are of good report. These are all things that can penetrate. You get a bad report, and that bad report can come into your soul and cause turmoil, says the Apostle Paul. If you think on good things, even the bad reports will not cause turmoil. Now, let me explain one more thing here. That doesn't mean that, for example, you hear the bad report of the death of somebody that you love, and you're troubled in your soul. There is a legitimate trouble. There's a legitimate mourning. There's a legitimate depression. Of course, we're not here to rob anybody of the emotional attachment that we have to other people and the plight of other people. Sure, we love them and we're troubled. Time and again, it says that Jesus was troubled in his soul, but he never lost fellowship. You see, that's the point. And there are several Greek words that are used as far as trouble is concerned. He never lost fellowship, and we'll show you how that can be done in just a little bit. But what I'm telling you here is that for your life, the peace of God is essential. An experiential assurance that you and God are in full fellowship, and that what is transpiring in your soul is the same type of condition that transpires in the soul of God that keeps him perpetually happy despite circumstances. All right, now we're going to go and discuss these points. Actually, we talked about them, but we just ran through them quickly. This hooper echo in verse number 7, passeth, is in what's known as the emphatic attributive position. Pastor, how can that help me? It can, because number one, it means that it's baffling. It's emphatic, meaning that when it comes to human understanding, it baffles human understanding. The world looks to strength either within itself or from others. We have two systems of strength. Either because we're weak, we either borrow from God's system to His glory, or we borrow from others. God's system is self-contained so that you need not borrow from others unless it is a very severe problem. And of course, you can talk it over with a Christian friend, or if it's that bad, with a pastor, or worse yet, a counselor. But if you've got it, it's beyond rational analysis. Secondly, it's beyond a beggar's description. You can't describe it to somebody who doesn't experience it. The Apostle Paul is in jail, and he's in total happiness. Sure, he wants out, but this condition did not upset him to the point of getting out of fellowship and charging God falsely. So his imprisonment serves as a background to the illustration. Now let's go back here again. Here's the command post, and the command post here has two people in it, you and the Lord, if your decisions are right. So you and the Lord have charge of this inner space. You have the peace of God within. Now, what's the illustration? Christ and Paul were in that prison room. But what's so good about it is that Paul looked out and said, there's the garrison. Look at those big old muscular Roman legionnaires out there. They've got a sword, they've got a shield, they've got a spear. They have the ability to call in more reinforcements. My enemies are not going to get in here. I can rest and relax with peace on the inside because the sentinels are guarding on the outside. And that becomes the vivid illustration for the point made here. I can relax in my soul because God is guarding through Bible doctrine the enemies that might attack. Okay, now one more thing here. It says that it keeps your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. The word through is in the instrumental of association. So it means that you could translate it by means of or with the means of the power provided by Christ. But you must be in union with Him. If He's not in the inner space with you, He was with Paul. But if He's not there with you and you're out of fellowship, you have no power. Positive thinking. It's not this, I'll grit my teeth and see my way through. That's not the peace of God. The peace of God is supernatural. Hooper echo. It's above and beyond. It is a supernatural means of total relaxation and reliance upon God despite the outer circumstances of life. Point at issue, stay in fellowship. That's where the peace of God is found. All right, now we have further illustrations of this last point. Can see that I think it's so important. We have stayed here and drilled for a whole lot of oil. Well, we're going to go deeper. John chapter 14. John chapter 14, and we're going to look at verse number 27. Now we're going to discuss the first words in a two-word phrase in each of these verses that we're going to discuss. Peace I leave with you. Note, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled. Troubled hearts are the opposite of peaceful hearts. Turmoil in your soul is the opposite of order and harmony in your soul. So Jesus Christ says, my peace, emos, my own personal peace, the one that He used. When Jesus Christ lived on this planet, He never let anybody get Him so upset that He lost fellowship. This is the peace I'm talking about. The world be hanged, says the Lord. I still have peace. Look here, I want to live at peace with you, but if you're not going to respond to my hailing of peace, That's your problem. So the peace that he uses is the one that we have. Now, let's, with the time we have remaining, we're going to wade through a few verses here on this point. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that is his own personal peace that you can share. And we're going to see through the use of a story related to us in Scripture, how that this can be applied. Turn to the book of Mark, chapter 4. Now we're going to use a story that is a literal happening of Christ and the disciples on the Sea of Galilee. And it is going to be a story that is going to be an analogy to your soul and mine. Verse number 35. And the same day when evening was come, he said to them, "Let's pass over onto the other side." So we're at dusk. It's beginning to be dark here. And they had sent away the multitude. They took him, even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. Now please note, there arose a great storm of wind. Literally, we would call it a tornado, where you've got the wind cycling back and forth, and you have the swirling winds here, and eventually they cause a suction, and it was causing problems, havoc on the Sea of Galilee. I wouldn't want to be on a tornado on land, let alone on water. It was a whirlwind that had come off the mountains close to Galilee and had come down right onto the sea. Now, it was a great, in other words, a tremendous storm. Not only was it dark, but now they were stuck, and what were they going to do? The waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. So you have literally a whirlpool going round and round that was started by a whirlwind, and to boot, now I'm just going to draw our little boat here, to boot, the waves were beginning to fill the ship and it was sinking into the vortex of this whirlpool. Boy, what a predicament. But now I want to show you peace. And he, Jesus Christ, was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. That's great. To me, up and down, what are we going to do, fellas? We're about to sink. You know how bad I am on an airplane. It'd be worse here on a ship if I was about to go down. What are we going to do? Now, here's somebody at peace. In the midst of the circumstances, which were obviously in just a short time, they were going to go down. Jesus Christ knew that the Father's care for him, and he simply was resting and relaxing, knowing that the Father would take care of him. Ah, but the rest were troubled. They awakened him. They said, "Master, don't you care that we perish?" He arose and, note, he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Present imperative. I command you to be always still. Now, the other words were perfect passive. Now that you're restrained, stay that way. Be muzzled, be restrained, stay that way. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Now, the word for great is this word in the Greek, mega, and the calm was galene. And it simply means now that the once rough waters were now absolutely the length and width of the lake. That's what it means, mega. The whole thing was now placid, smooth as glass, no more storm. Now, what is the upshot of this for you and for me? Let's go back to our soul. We have talked about the fact that there is a stream of consciousness in the soul. All right? Now, under normal conditions, that stream of consciousness simply goes round and round and round, bringing thoughts from our imager all the way around back up into the imager again. That's the stream of consciousness. A troubled soul, you see, the soul being a spiritual, of spiritual nature, is fluid. It can move, you see. So you have this thing cycling round and round. A troubled soul is where the thing begins to move faster and faster and faster and faster, and that causes what? Well, just like when water or wind moves faster and faster, you form a vortex here. What happens with a vortex? With a vortex, those that are, well, I'll just draw it up here. Those that are on the top part, if you've ever seen Moby Dick and the ship of Captain Ahab, and Moby Dick went around and around and around and around, and the outer circumstances formed this vortex, and the ship finally simply fell into the bottomless pit, as it were. But anything underneath is sucked up to the top, so that the mud and the mire of the bottom is sucked up to the top. Anything on top is sucked down. Now, if you are a scientist and you talk about pulsar stars, they are ones that go around and around and around, and they finally spin so fast, forming that vortex, that they collapse in on themselves and form what's called a black hole, where there is total suction inwardly. Now, what's that have to do with you? Your soul, here's your volition, has both a conscious and a subconscious thing. Your subconscious has a lot of the mud and the mire. Your conscious mind has a lot of activity going on there. And it goes around and around and around and around, and eventually you collapse in on yourself. That's depression. That's a mental instability. That's a schizophrenic personality, where you're split-souled, you're double-minded, and so forth. That's exactly what it means. These things come down to the bottom, these things come up to the top, and in the realm of the center of your soul, you're troubled, you're in trouble. The only thing that you can do at this point is to have Jesus Christ come to the bow of your boat and say, "Peace. Be still." That's it. You see, that's the peace of God. "My peace I give to you." Otherwise, in the time of life, you're going to have this happen to you where you collapse on the inside. How many times we've done it? You've experienced it. I've experienced it. That's what causes it. We get troubled so that this spins so fast, it constantly brings back to mind our troubles, and we're presented with them. And we can't get them out of our mind, we say. "You were on my mind," this, that type of thing. But our problems are on my mind. Keep up to the forefront. But it causes turmoil here. And eventually, if that is not resolved by peace, you collapse in on yourself. Oh, you can put a false face on the outside and you can function everyday life, but on the inside you have turmoil of soul. Now, this is a result, as it were, of punishment. Let's go to the book of Isaiah. If you don't have the stability of Christ speaking peace to your soul, sharing His peace, Isaiah 57. Now, please follow this with me because it's very important. Isaiah 57, 20 and 21. "But the wicked are like a troubled sea." What's a troubled sea? It's one that has a great storm of wind that hits it, and it whirls it around and whirls it around and causes a vortex or a whirlpool. And anybody that is caught on the top goes down, and the muck and the mire and the mud is siphoned up so that the waters are muddied. That's more confusion. Your soul has all types of things going on now. That causes simply more confusion. What was stored in your subconscious is now out, and now you really have problems. There is no peace, saith my God, to the wicked. You're unsaved, out of fellowship, this is going to happen to you. A natural course of life. Chapter 59, verse 8. Why does this happen to them? The way of peace they know not, there is no judgment in their goings. They don't know the word of God. They make wrong decisions. They don't have the peace of God ruling in their heart or keeping their heart with a garrison. So therefore, there's no judgment. And when you make the wrong decisions, you're like a troubled sea. Let's go to Psalms now. Psalms 83. Psalms 83, verse number 13. O my God, make them, that is the wicked, like a wheel. Only it's not just the concept of a wheel, it's the concept of a spinning item. A whirlwind, a whirlpool, or a wheel. You've all seen these pinwheels where the wind catches it and it's so fashioned and shaped where it looks like it's going right to the board. That's what it's talking about here. As stubble before the wind, as fire burns wood, as a flame sets mountains on fire, so persecute them, note, with a tempest. Make them afraid with thy storm. Fill their faces with shame that they may seek thy name. This is the only way you can have peace, when Christ speaks it to your soul. Let them be confounded and troubled forever. Let them be put to shame and perish. That's the lot of the wicked. That's the lot of the carnal, eventually. The wicked go into hell like a wheel in their soul, everything spinning around. And their problems sink down, they're depressed, and their problems come up. All the muck and the mire that they have suppressed for their lifetime. And it is just simply the waters are clouded and they're confused forever. Let them be like a wheel, a whirlpool literally in their soul. All right. Now, one more thing along these lines. Come with me to the book of Ephesians. The book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Now, this same thing is going to be addressed to Christians. Why do we function under the operation of gap? Why insist so often that this is the way? Simply because, if not, verse 14, you are a child, Ephesians 4:14, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine. You see, you're going to sink. The false doctrine is going to be siphoned up, and what's going to happen? You're tossed to and fro, you're going to sink down. The only way that you can have the peace of God is to know the bond of peace, verse 3, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The bond of peace is a like-minded approach to the Christian way of life, where you as an entity, or your church or family or whatever as an entity, thinks the same way doctrinally, so that the peace of Jesus Christ becomes your peace that stabilizes your life. He can say, "Peace, be still," and there was a great calm. He speaks it to your soul And the every bit from the length, the width, the depth of your soul is now stabilized. All right, let's introduce you to the next point in this study. The book of Psalms 119. And verse number 165. Now, because of our time, we probably are only going to be able to introduce this to you and give you the illustration the next time. The second point that illustrates our third point in the overall outline, the peace of God, is simply that we not only have the personal peace of Christ, but we can have, note verse 165, great peace. Great peace have they that do what? Which love thy law. Here's our concept. Number one, peace from God, down from God, is his hail of peace. Number two, our response in faith is our saying, Lord, I want to live at peace with you. We can have experienced peace one and two, but peace three comes in two ways. Number one, your volition, making right choices in favor of finalizing what you're going to do in your life. This is God's will for my life. This is the choice that I make. And peace floods your soul. But then the second thing comes by it keeping your soul. How can it do that? All right, by thinking doctrinal things, by flooding your soul with doctrine. Then it says, great peace have they which love thy law. When the word of God is first priority, great peace fills your soul, and nothing shall offend them. Now, the word offend there means to disturb their tranquility of mind. If your life is filled with Bible doctrine and you're doing the right thing for God, nobody can get your goat. Isn't that great? A lot of folks like to get the goat of other people. They like to put them down. They like to shame them in front of others and so forth. Ooh, you're a Christian. Ooh, you go to church. Oh, you study that much. We just go just a short time. We don't need all that doctrine. And you simply think to yourself, great peace have they which love thy law. Oh, Lord, let them be as a wheel. Now, we don't pray imprecatory prayers here at the Dispensation of Grace, but you sure would like, oh, that's okay, Lord. Bible says they're like a wheel. Oh, spin them around, Lord. I'll tell you what, it wouldn't take me very long to spin around and to not get right, because I get dizzy so fast. You see, that's the idea. You get dizzy. You get seasick. Even the stoutest sailor in a situation where you're spinning in the vortex of a whirlpool, you're going to get sick and frightened. Now, but great peace have they which love thy law. The word of God is a stabilizer. Nothing shall offend them. The word great, as we're closing here, is the Hebrew rab. It means, just like the word passes, passeth all understanding, hooper echo, it's above and beyond. You have and behold that which is, and hold, which is above and beyond human comprehension, great peace. It transcends the norm, it's supernatural, and it extends to every area of your life. Just like with the Sea of Galilee, from the north end to the south end, from the east to the west, it was totally calm, so that they now could choose the direction they wanted to go without sinking. The Word of God is that type of stabilizer.